Praise God, praise God. Let the people of God say amen, amen. I welcome you to the Bread Broadcast, a Bible teaching program where we edify, we exalt, and we challenge believers to the Great Commission. Here, we also call sinners to repentance through the gospel of Jesus Christ. Thank you for joining us. Today, we are going to be talking about the four truths about mankind. Now, when I say mankind, it's the species of humans, okay? Man, woman, boy, girl is mankind. So the case study is going to be Adam and you. Adam and Joseph and Zion, okay? And your short reading, you are to like this one. It's Genesis, the book of the beginnings, chapter 3, verse 17. You start at 24. Genesis 3, 17 to 24. Let us pray. Father, thank you for bringing us here. Dear Jesus, thank you for your blood, which you shed to save us. Sweet blessed Holy Spirit, thank you for calling us to salvation and for keeping us in our faith walk. Lord, as I lift Jesus up, according to your word, Father, draw people unto yourself. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. All right, our foundation text is the book of Acts, 17, verse 30 to 31. Acts 17, 30. I will stop at 31. Truly, these times of ignorance God overlooked, but now commands all men, all women, everywhere to repent, because he has appointed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by the man whom he has ordained. And who is the man God ordained? He has given assurance. This is how you are going to know the man with a capitalized M whom God has ordained, by giving us the assurance of this to all by raising him from the dead. Hallelujah. God said, whoever rises up from the dead and doesn't die again, he is the one I've chosen. Amen. All right. What are the four truths about mankind that we can learn, that I can learn from Adam, that you can learn, that you can learn from Adam? In some areas, I'm going to be brief because there's a part of this lesson that is really heavy. So we need to spend some time in that area. So the truth number one is there is a universal accusation. Here is the charge against Adam. According to Genesis 3:17, we are not going to read that. We are going to be making references to a lot of Bible passages which we are not going to read. God said to Adam, because you have eaten from the tree of which I commanded you, saying, thou shalt not eat out of it. That is the accusation. That is the charge that was brought against Adam. That was what he did wrong. But to our generation, the same accusation is thus worded. In John 3:18c, again, we are not reading that, because he has not believed. That is the charge that God is now putting out against the world. This is the accusation. Because he or she has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. That is the same accusation that is going out, even as the accusation went out against Adam. It's all based in disobedience. Every human is under this accusation, regardless of color, creed, and culture. Listen up, track with me. No one was born believing Jesus from birth. Nobody. If anybody tells you, I've been born again from my mama's womb, they're liars. Okay? This is why we are called sinners. You've ever met a perfect person, huh? Somebody was talking to me yesterday. We were texting. And she said, oh, I'm sorry. And I said, did I tell you I was perfect? I said, until I'm perfect, we are good working together, you see. We are all imperfect, spiritually defective group of people. Dr. Rogers, one of my favorite preachers, he said, you are a sinner, not because you're sinning. You're sinning because you are a sinner, you see. A house made with red bricks, you can scrub it from here till next year until your face turns blue, it's going to remain red. Why? Because the brick was made of a red mud or red color, you see. Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. That's it. End of story. It doesn't matter how hard you try to be good, to be perfect, you will still fall short. From now to 1,000,000 years, you will still fall short. Sin is to the human king what pigmentation is to the human skin. Let me say that again. If you are white, you are not white because you shower too much. If you are black-skinned, you are not black-skinned because you don't shower. What dictated your skin color, what gave you your skin color is in your blood. Sin is to the human king. What pigmentation is to the human skin. So it's not because you have done something wrong that the Bible says you are a sinner. No, you are a sinner by birth, okay? And then you choose wrongly as you grow. I choose wrongly as I grow. And that makes us sinner. Moving on. There is a universal condemnation. God said to Adam, the day you eat of it, that is the fruit, you shall die. God repeats the same verdict to our modern age. John 3:19, we are now reading. God said, this is the condemnation, that the light has come into the world, that is into the system to show himself to people, and men loved darkness rather than light because their deeds are evil, you see. Before you do evil with your actions, your heart has first been evil, you see. Your hands only carry out what your heart dictated. That's it. Adam died his natural death some 900 years after his spiritual death. The moment he disobeyed God, he died spiritually. But he still lived 900 years, you see, ever since. Listen up. Ever since, every son or daughter of Adam has been under the same condemnation of spiritual death while physically living. Many people that you see on your TV, many people that you rub shoulders with on your street or workplaces, they are dead people walking. They are still breathing, but they are dead. Of being spiritually blind, why they can physically see, you see. They can see natural stuff, but they are spiritually blind. Regardless of who they are or what they have, it doesn't matter. It cuts across. It's a universal condemnation. John 9:39. And Jesus said, for judgment I come into this world, that those who do not see may see, and that those who see may be blind. What is that telling you? People look at Christians, I mean real believers, the people of the world, they look at us, they laugh, they deride us, and they're like, shh, they're crazy people. Someone said we are mentally something. I don't know that she said about the vice president, that because Jesus speaks to the vice president, he said that's mental illness. You see, that individual, if you ask her, she thinks she can see. But Bible believers, we know she's spiritually blind. And lady, if you are watching me, you are spiritually blind. You need Jesus, okay? So people who think, oh, I'm good, I'm smart, but they have no spiritual consciousness, they are not connected to Jesus, they are spiritually blind. They can only see. Death is a debt that you owe to own. You see, either way, everybody is gonna die. It's a debt. But the type of death that you choose, you own it. It's your choice. So you can be born once and die twice, which is no good. Or be born twice and die once. That is why we use the term born again. You see, when you are born naturally from your mother's womb, and then you give your life to Jesus, and then you are born from above, that is your second birth. You only need to die one time in the natural, and you don't die anymore. So the death is a debt. Your death, my death, is a debt that you owe to own. Everybody is going to die one day, if the Lord tarries. There is a universal salvation. The Lord God made tunics of skin and clothed Adam and Eve. That's Genesis 3:21. In God's dictionary, sin means death. The wages of sin is death. That's what the Bible says. The death of the sinner or the substitute. Either way, sin must be paid for. God killed an animal for Adam and Eve. From then on, God will only accept blood sacrifice because blood means life. If you want to see somebody dead, cut them open and let them begin to bleed. In no time, that person will die. Why? Because blood is life, you see. That's why God accepted the offering of Abel, because Abel brought a lamb and killed it. In other words, he's saying, God, I want to be doing this, but you know, I can't bring my blood because I need to do this next time to worship you. So he killed a lamb. But Cain brought fruit and vegetables, and God rejected it because it brought works of his hand, you see. Because the Bible says, you will till the ground out of your sweat. So he thought he was doing a great thing for God. He brought works, but it's from a cursed source. The ground has been cursed. And God said, no, don't bring that to me. It's still the same thing. If you are believing in your good works, it's cursed. It's the religion of Cain. And God will not have anything to do with that. Nevertheless, blood sacrifices did not meet God's standard of perfect holiness, even though God instituted the animal sacrifice offerings from the time of Garden of Eden, when he killed that animal. And from then, people have been killing animals. But God said, still, it's not good enough. Why? Number one, because God's ultimate plan was to save Adam's descendants. According to, number one, his promise in the garden when he rebuked Eve that the seed of the woman will bruise the head of the serpent. And then he promised Abram in Genesis chapter 12 verse 3 that through Abram, all the descendants of the earth will be blessed. You see? So that's God's ultimate plan, to save everybody. However, in Exodus 12, 43 to 48, the Passover was instituted for the Jews only. What happened? The world was crazy in the time of Abram. So God only found Abram, whose heart was after God. And God said, okay, let me start with you. You see, the Egyptians, the Ethiopians, they are doing their own crazy stuff over there in Africa. And the Assyrians and all that, they were doing their own crazy stuff too. The Canaanites, the Jebusites and all that. And God said, your heart is after me, Abram, come. I will start with you. And so from Abram descended the Jews. And by the time they got to Exodus, when they were in Egypt in slavery, God instituted the Passover, but it's only for the Jews only. However, remember, God's plan was for the whole world. So, by the time they came out of Egypt from the house of slavery and they were in the wilderness, the book of Leviticus started. Now, starting from Leviticus chapter 1, all through Leviticus, God established various animal sacrifices, peace offering, sin offering, trespass offering, burnt offerings, grain offerings, all kinds of sacrifices and offerings. They were prescribed by God to cover for the sins of Israel or Israelites. So if you are sinned personally, there's a prescribed animal or animals that you will bring to the high priest to so they can kill that animal for you, lest the anger of God breaks out against you, you see. And once a year, the whole Israel, they will come together for Yom Kippur, whereby they will do a corporate sacrifice that God should forgive all their sins. So they continued with this, but by the time we came to the time of the prophet Ezekiel, I hope you are following me, please. The animal sacrifices have become abominations to God. And God said in Ezekiel 44, verse 6 to 8, we are not going to read that. He said, don't bring to us. Now God used the same name he used in Genesis 1:26, Elohim. That's his plural form, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. He said, do not bring to us any more of your sacrifices. It's abomination. Why? Because before they deliberately go into sin, guess what? It's like, oh, if I go and steal, I will just bring one goat to the high priest, and my sin will be cleansed. That's it. So they will go and do the evil they wanted to do, and then bring animal sacrifice to bring animal to the temple to be sacrificed. And God said, this is a joke. Stop it. You see? So God's plan would require a perfect human whose death would pay for the condemnation passed on all humans. It gets better. Listen now. Are you watching this? Don't sleep. Come on. God's perfect human showed up some 4,000 years after Adam at the Jordan River to be baptized by John the Baptist. John saw him, and according to John chapter 1, verse 29, he said, the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world. Hallelujah. His name was Jesus. Come on now. Jesus' death satisfied God's demand for justice to pay for every sin because he did not have the blood of Adam. I wish you could go into that, because a lot of people, they ask, was Jesus tempted with adultery, with stealing? No, he was not. He was tempted in the 3 points that formed the root of all the problems that we have in the world. You see, stealing, adultery, those are just like branches. But he was tempted in the 3 points: lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. He was tempted to be independent of God. He was tempted to not worship God, to worship Satan, and he was tempted to do a show off, to stroke his own ego, and he did not bow to any of those temptations. Those are the 3 roots of all the problems that we have in the world, you see. But was he tempted to look at a woman? He was not tempted to sin. He did not have the blood of Adam. It's the blood of Adam that makes us to be lustful and all that. Jesus was God in human skin. Let me say that again. Jesus was God in human skin. If any 2 devils knock your door to come give you some doctrines of demons that Jesus is not God, it's a lie from the pit of hell. Jesus was God in human skin. Jesus is God. Amen. God's plan to save the Jews and non-Jews has been realized after Jesus died on the cross. His desire to bring imperfect people to his perfect heaven without compromising his own perfection has been established. Salvation is now universal through Jesus alone, by having faith in Jesus alone. How? Like someone who believes their government's financial declaration that the money in their hand is legal tender, no matter where they are or what they wear. Listen, I brought this for analogy. This is paper. This is paper. Are you looking at me? All right? I can write with a pen on this. I can write with a pen on this. This, I can tear into pieces. I can tear this into pieces too. You see, they have so many similarities. This can burn in the fire. This can burn in the fire. But if I take this to the grocery store, if I go to the grocery store to want to buy something, they will either call the cops on me or kick me out of their store. Why? This is nothing. But if I hold this in my hand to want to buy something from the grocery store, they cannot refuse me. Why? Because it's legitimate, you see. It's got the seal of the Treasury of the United States on it, you see. And it says I can spend it anywhere in America. Now, if they refuse it, they will be in trouble. Not me, you see. And the same $1 I'm holding is not different from the one that you find in the wallet of Bill Gates. I don't know if he's still the richest man. Yeah, I don't know. But it's still the same $1, you see. Faith is like that. Now, I'm not saying you buy faith, no. But faith in Jesus is like that. You believe what you have heard about Jesus and go to God and say, I believe what I've heard about Jesus, that his death has paid for all my sins. I now put my trust in Jesus. That's it. You believe just the way you believe your government for this paper. That is called money. That is it. That's it. Let's go to Ephesians 2. We start from verse 8, we stop at 9. Ephesians 2, 8 to 9. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, for it is the gift of God. You see, it is the gift of God, not of works, not by anything you have done, lest anyone should boast. Romans 10, 9. And this is how you practicalize your faith, that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. That's it. No one has goofed enough to be accepted from Christ's cross. And no one has been good enough to be exempted from Christ's cross. No, you can't say, oh, I've been so bad, God will not accept me. That is not in the Bible. And you cannot say, I'm too good, I don't need Jesus. That is not in the Bible. No one has goofed enough to be accepted from Christ's cross. And no one has been good enough to be exempted from Christ's cross. Moving on. There is a universal perpetuation. Adam and Eve died in the natural, but they are in heaven because God clothed them with tunics of skin of the animal killed for them. For us, it means whoever wears the robe of Christ's righteousness by believing in Jesus and having their sins forgiven will live forevermore. Hallelujah. The body may die, but the soul lives forever. Jesus made us realize that the souls of the rich man and Lazarus continue to live, even as we speak. The rich man in the bottomless pit, since over 2,000 years ago. Can you believe that? And Lazarus in paradise. That story is in Luke 16, 19-31. Listen up. Listen. Please, watch me. Every dead person will be raised from the dead to meet with Jesus face to face. Oh, yeah. If you die before Jesus comes, guess what? You will be raised from the dead and you are going to meet Jesus face to face. You have a date to keep. I have a date to keep with Jesus. But he can be a judge or your Lord. It's your choice. When I see him, oh, glory to God. He is my Lord. Why? I've given my life to him. Is he your Lord or is he going to be a judge? You choose. Some unto eternal life after they are raised from the dead, and some unto eternal damnation, as Daniel said in 12:22 of his book. I love to cap it the way Dr. McGee said it. He said, he took my hell down there that I might take his heaven up yonder. Listen, I already took his heaven up yonder. How about you? Huh? John 5:24. This is Jesus himself speaking. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that hears my word and believes on him that sent me has everlasting life. He did not say has 6 months life or 3 years life. No, once you are saved and you are given the gift of salvation by Jesus and you are convinced that your sins have been forgiven, you are sealed with the Holy Spirit. Not for 6 months, not for 3 years, because some people say you can fall out. I don't know where they find that. This is Jesus himself saying, you have everlasting life and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life. Hallelujah. With your desired selection, you design your destination. With your desired selection, you design your destination. So it's your selection, heaven or hell. When you select, you design your destination. So, what have we done so far? What are the four truths about mankind? Number one, there's a universal accusation. Through Adam, we all disobeyed God. There's a universal condemnation. This is spiritual death while naturally alive. There's a universal salvation. Christ died for everyone in every race and culture. There's a universal perpetuation. By individual's choice, we all face one option of eternity in heaven with Jesus or damnation in the lake of fire. If you are not a believer, or you are not sure that your sins have been forgiven, this is a great opportunity for you. Oh yeah. Why? You may not live to see tomorrow. Tomorrow may never come. This may be the last sermon that you will hear about Jesus. I mean, real sermon that will not tickle your ear to make you feel good. You may not have another chance. Jesus did everything for you not to go to hell. He already took your hell, you see. Not that he's going to. He already took it. So you don't have to go to hell. All he's asking is that you believe in him. That you receive him into your heart. To receive or reject him is entirely up to you. You have been told the truth. You have been told the truth. The times of your ignorance, God has overlooked. When you did all the bad stuff that you did, listen, if you knew better, you wouldn't have done that. God said, don't worry about it. Okay? But now, from this very moment, he's commanding you to repent. Are you ready to repent? Huh? Are you ready? If you are ready, I'm going to say a quick prayer. A link is coming up. Follow that link. Father God, thank you, Holy Spirit, for helping me to deliver that message through the platform that you have given me in your ministry. Lord, as many that will be following that link, guide them, open their hearts in the name of Jesus. Let them meet with you. And if there still be anyone who is yet to commit to you, Lord, give them restlessness until they rest in you. And for all your children, let your mercy, peace, and love be multiplied unto us in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. I will see you next week, only if Jesus has not split the sky open.